Hi everyone, greetings from Istanbul in Turkey. Thank you for stopping by our channel. This is Royal Africa Television. To our returning subscribers, we really appreciate you for watching all our videos. If you're new here, please start by subscribing and be part of this amazing family. My name is Regan. A pleasure as always having you watching us. It's been a while we had an interview on Royal Africa Television, but then, like you know, we always like to inform, entertain and educate you at the same time. Reasons why we are bringing you this interview today is going to be an interesting topic which I'll be unraveling to you in the minutes and seconds ahead. But before we do that, please meet my guest. It is somebody that has spoken to us on Royal Africa Television before, and it's always amazing to have him because he is a bag of knowledge and he never hesitates to want to share with us. Hello, Doctor. Thanks for accepting us again today.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Please tell our viewers your name for those who might be seeing you for the first time.
I'm Dr. William Mosier. I practice developmental pediatrics, and I am a professor at Istanbul Gelişim University.
Okay. Okay, doctor. Thank you so much for granting us time out of your busy schedule. And I'll use this opportunity to appreciate you for helping me out during my second pregnancy, because guys, that's where we're heading to. We're going to be talking about pregnant women today. And you want to know that pregnancy concerns everybody. The person that gets the lady pregnant, the lady herself. And if you have a pregnant relative, of course, you'll be wishing the person well and hoping, because life is something we all enjoy and look forward to. So the birth of a new born is a thing that everybody, a normal person, should be happy about. So Dr. Ye helped me a lot throughout my second pregnancy. Tips, advices, and medical consultation for free. I practically could understand what was happening to the baby in me, the fetus at that time. And yeah, it made me have a pretty easy experience during my second childbirth, unlike the first. So I'm really grateful to you for that.
You're welcome.
Thank you, sir. So now, today, what are we talking about? I want us to talk about working out in pregnancy, exercising. Why this topic? Well, I'm pregnant for my third, and I noticed, or I discovered, that I was pregnant when I had taken up on a workout routine. I've always loved working out. So, you know, this habit, you drop and pick it up. But I was like, okay, this time around, I'm building a lifestyle out of this. I'm not waiting to, okay, I want to lose weight. Okay, I have some goals, long or short-term goals. No, I just wanted to keep working out. So I was in the process and I discovered that I was pregnant and I didn't want to stop. And so some friends were curious, like, oh, Regan, you're pregnant and you're working out. And then I tried convincing them beyond my ability that I think it's safe, I feel safe, but some were really frightened. And then I said, okay, why not take this to a medical personnel, a professional who will be able to soothe their minds a little. So that's the prompt behind this interview, doctor.
Okay.
Okay, so straight into the first question. Is it safe for a pregnant woman to be working out?
Not only is it safe, it's preferable, especially if a woman has what's called gestational diabetes or hypertension during pregnancy. It is absolutely vital that the woman at least walks every day during her pregnancy. And if a woman, like yourself, is into regular exercise programs, there is in no way any research that substantiates that's dangerous for the developing fetus inside.
Does it cut across the three trimesters or limited to some times?
Doesn't matter whether it's in the first trimester, second, or third. A woman should do as much physical activity as she's capable of doing, because the way God made the body, the woman's uterus has a placenta that will take care of the baby while the mother is exercising.
Nice. So yeah, some people get scared, like the baby could just jump out of you because you're walking or jumping.
No, it doesn't work that way. That is not possible.
Yes. So doctor, let's talk about risk pregnancy. We know that there are some pregnancies that the doctors term risk, and they might say, get a bed rest or something like that.
These are rare cases. Much more common when you marry a cousin. So that doesn't apply in your case. So the types of high-risk pregnancies are so rare that you know in the first trimester if a woman is in those high-risk pregnancies. And there's some pieces of information that are hard for people to swallow about pregnancy. Now, this world has 8 billion people on the planet.
Yeah.
And with 8 billion people, how come we're still here? How come we survived and the dinosaurs didn't? Because Homo sapiens are really adaptive animals.
Yeah.
And we've only had medicine for about 4,000 years, but we've been Homo sapiens for 200,000 years, for about 2 million to 200,000 years ago. We became what we are now, and that makes many, many more years of delivering babies without anyone to help the woman than there were hospitals to take care of women.
I see. Talking about working out, are there specific exercises you recommend or just any safe?
Whatever the woman wants to do. Certainly it's not prudent to go horseback running, riding where you're galloping,
yeah.
But even horseback riding, if the horse is just walking, is okay. But even better is the woman getting in at least 10,000 steps a day.
Whoa.
And that's about, and most people don't want to do this, but that's about 2 hours of walking in a day.
Whoa.
Yes.
I think it's easier if you just, like I usually do, sit on a program.
Yes.
Like there are lots of walking exercises online that you do these days without having to go out of your house.
Exactly.
Indoor. Marching, walking, like, okay, maybe a friend asked me, she feared that she had a miscarriage, and she feared that it might have been because she didn't know that she was pregnant and she was involved in, you know, the app movement.
Exercises. That's probably not why she had the miscarriage.
Yeah.
See, this is a hard thing for people who don't understand anatomy to realize, but the average woman is pregnant 3 times before she actually has a baby that's viable for life. In other words, there's typically 2 miscarriages before your first pregnancy even. But the woman just assumes, oh, my period's late.
Yeah.
But the research in the literature is quite clear that most times when a woman had a, what the average person calls a miscarriage, but in medicine we call a spontaneous abortion.
Mm-hmm.
When the spontaneous abortion occurs, that means the uterus is sloughing it off because it wasn't viable for life. And think about all of the diseases that, whether it's genetic or congenital diseases, that can bring a baby into the world, like most people know what Down syndrome is, that doesn't slough from the uterus. But if a woman has this labeled miscarriage, that is spontaneous abortion, the uterus is saying, this one's not going to be viable for life.
Oh,
so it's best for us to clean the uterus to get it ready for the next birth.
I see. Mm-hmm. Okay, that explains a lot. Because we generally, you know, there are lots of myths around being pregnant.
Yes, a lot of myths.
Yes, by God's grace, I've been pregnant twice, and I know what I used to hear about pregnancy, what I experienced, and the realities. Most times, the myths are different from the reality, because thinking that, okay, you know, we know that the first trimester, the baby, the fetus is still blurred.
The first one? Right?
The fetus isn't
even a fetus at first. It's an ovum,
okay,
which is the Latin word for egg.
Yes.
So even though an egg and a sperm get together and form what's called an ovum, the name for that is an egg, but it's not the egg from the woman. It's now when the egg and the sperm fertilize, that now becomes an ovum for about 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay. How secure is that one? Like the probability of losing the pregnancy before it gets to that stage?
Only if the uterus gets the message,
like you just explained,
that this is not going to be viable for life. Because during those first 2 or 3 weeks, not just an ovum is developing, which is going to eventually turn into a fetus, a baby, but also a placenta develops that's going to provide nutrition to the baby, and an umbilical cord starts being created. So we're talking about three separate things that are forming in those first 2 to 3 weeks that if there's some sort of mismessage in the development, then the body says, or specifically the uterus says, this one's not going to be viable. It's not going to turn into a real human being. So let's clean out the uterus and start over. That's where the heavy bleeding comes from.
Oh, I get it. All right. It explains it. Okay, doctor, do you recommend at any stage, maybe some ladies feel like, okay, oh, another question I got, which I'd like you to shed some light on, is does exercising, this working out, will it push you into premature labor?
Absolutely not. That's only, we're talking about extreme exercise. Do you plan on running a 5-kilometer race?
No, just basic morning and evening.
So if you ran a 5-kilometer jog race, then okay, that could induce a message from the hypothalamus in the brain, sending a message down to the uterus saying, we need some oxytocin to start contractions, but that's still going to be about a 24-hour period because the os, the cervix of the woman, has to stretch big enough for the head to come out. So whether it comes out butt first or head first, still, it has to stretch out. And so under normal circumstances, just healthy movement, and as I said, equivalent to 10,000 steps a day, and just cleaning the house, walking around indoors, gives you about 2,500 steps in a day. So if a woman decides to, on top of that, do some sort of exercise regime, whether it's yoga or walking on a Stairmaster or doing an elliptical, that's perfectly healthy because it lowers the risk of gestational diabetes, lowers the risk of hypertension during pregnancy. And if one carries the gene for diabetes in their family or carries the gene for hypertension in their family, that's something you want to be conscious of. And so assuming a person doesn't have one of those rare high-risk pregnancies, then you should exercise as much as you're comfortable with, because no pregnant woman is going to want to run full speed for 5 kilometers. It's just, you won't have the energy for that when you're pregnant.
I think so. Well, and there's something we always say, listen to your body.
Exactly. Because
I think your body tells you, even before the doctor tells you, if it's safe, if it's advantageous. Talking about advantages, you just gave like 2. Any other advantages you want to share with us about working out during pregnancy?
Well, the big advantage is to decrease the risk of gestational diabetes in the mother,
yes,
or and decrease the risk of hypertension during pregnancy. So those are 2 powerful reasons why exercising is important. And in with the modern day diet, it is very, there seems to be an increased risk of gestational diabetes,
yeah,
and hypertension during pregnancy because of the modern fast food diet. Mm-hmm. So the more exercise that is reasonable exercise,
yes,
that's roughly equivalent to 2 hours of movement, which ends up being roughly 10,000 steps in a day, is absolutely healthy for you and the developing baby.
And you mentioned of my helping you out with labor, easing labor.
Well, the big, like when I taught you and your husband how to do Lamaze, the breathing technique that,
yes,
makes labor more tolerable,
yeah,
so that you can cope without the physical discomfort being so intense. What happens when you exercise, you're getting more oxygen to the baby because you're breathing more,
yeah,
because you're exercising. And so that oxygen doesn't just go to your brain, it's also going through the umbilical cord into the fetus. So it's advantageous for the baby. And when you're in the third trimester of pregnancy, because you've been physically active, then the labor process, which is not what people see on television and what people hear about from the average OBGYN gynecologist, it should be a fast process. It's typically 24 hours. So with you being on your third child now, it may only be 8 to 12 hours because the cervix stretches more easily after the first child. Mm. So it all depends upon how fast the cervix dilates. Yeah. Dilation is meaning stretching out. Mm-hmm. And that's determined by how many pregnancies a person has already brought to fruition, not counting cesarean sections. Mm. So if a person has accepted doctors saying, oh no, you can't deliver vaginally, you have to have a cesarean section, which is a big myth, because what did we do thousands of years ago? Everybody.
They scare you with things like their complications, mm-hmm, the baby's breached, the baby's coming with the hand, not the, like, you know, most times we believe that it's only with the head. If it's not the head, then you're at risk.
Well,
maybe the feet are coming first.
Even if the child is breached, that's just the term for if the head isn't, if this is the cervix, and if you would put your fist
like this,
like that, typically the head is in the cervix first.
Yes.
But what if it's the child's foot or one arm, as maybe invasive as this is going to sound? What the doctor does, any skilled physician gets trained to do this in medical school because you have to deliver babies when you're in medical school. It's boxes you have to check off. So with the over 100 babies that I've delivered in my career, even though I'm a pediatrician, not an obstetrician, I've still delivered over 100 babies, and every once in a while, there'd be a baby whose butt is stuck at the cervix instead, mm-hmm, of the head,
yeah,
or an arm or just one leg seems to be stuck there, then what you do is put your hand on the woman's abdomen and one hand in the cervix, and you twist the baby around between contractions to replace the head where it should be.
Does it actually manually you do that and the baby's head?
Yep.
Oh.
I've done that maybe a dozen times. Mm-hmm. Now, if the contractions and the cervix is already fully dilated, so it's too late to do that, then even delivering breech birth, I've delivered about four babies breech birth. They came out butt first, but you just...
gently and slowly.
Yeah, you just wait till the next contraction, then a little more comes out, then you wait till the next contraction, then a little more comes out, and you help the woman breathe. And then eventually the head comes out.
Okay, doctor. Thank you so much for enlightening us on this. You know, ignorance is really, some people pay heavily for not having information. And I hope, viewers, that you find this informative enough and it's going to change some of the myths you have in your mind concerning pregnancy. As we round up, doctor, what general advice would you like to share with pregnant ladies out there?
One, you have to be kind to yourself. Yeah. Two, you have to understand that this is a process that God created, so it's a natural process. Mm-hmm. And the myth that women need a cesarean is not really accurate. Guess what percentage of babies really need a C-section, a cesarean section?
What
1.5. And since we can't cut babies in half, okay, I'll say 2%.
Yeah.
2 out of every 100 babies actually need to be born cesarean. So what are the odds of any woman who has normal pelvic girth to really need a cesarean section? It is rare. But in modern society, the three countries with the most embarrassing incidence of overuse of cesarean section are first Brazil, then the United States, then Turkey. This is a tragic phenomena. The reason there are more cesareans in Brazil than any other country is not because it's necessary, but because the social medical system there is set up so that doctors want to practice doing tummy tucks. A tummy tuck is like making the woman look thinner again. And so they do cesareans so they can practice their stitching for tummy tucks. And in the United States, it's mostly done because, whoa, I have a 24-hour shift today, and this lady's only dilated 4 centimeters. And so if I don't do a cesarean, I'm going to lose the paycheck for this pregnancy. I know you exactly. Capitalism in medicine is, from my perspective, immoral. That's why I moved from the U.S. to Turkey. And
in Turkey, they believe it's natural, but it's so painful. The woman shouldn't be led to go through that. Like the colleagues and others I've had, they tell me, oh, I don't have the patience or the courage. I'd rather just be torn up. I'm like, that's for me, it's a bigger pain, having to deal with the wound for weeks. So.
Now, that's an interesting fact. See, many women think who have either had an episiotomy, that's where the doctor wants to speed up the delivery, so he cuts a huge chunk of skin from your butt so that the cervix opens faster, so the baby comes out sooner. And the women who, the many, many women I work with who I hear saying, oh, I was in so much pain for so many weeks after my baby. Mm. It wasn't because of their delivery.
Because the stitches,
it was
of course.
The suturing that was done. Same thing with cesarean section. The stitching that was done is painful. And so the woman has about 3 weeks of discomfort. Whereas once you have natural childbirth and the baby comes out, like with my six children, my ex-wife and I had all six of them at home, and all of them were natural childbirth. And the one of our children that was born when I was working for UNICEF in Brazil, we were walking on Ipanema Beach 2 hours after she delivered because she said, I've got energy. I need to get up and walk. So we just got up and walked the beach with the baby in hand. Wow. Only 2 hours after she delivered. And it was the same for all six of the kids. Each delivery was roughly a little bit shorter than the first one was 24 hours. And then the next one was like 16 hours. Each labor is going to be a little bit shorter because of the flexibility in the cervix after having more children. But still, with our last child being 5.6 kilos, ooh, he was such a big baby. She wanted to rest like 4 hours before she wanted to get up and go for a walk. But we did. We got up. I let her decide when she wanted to. And 4 hours after we had the baby, she said, I want to go for a walk. I need to move. So we did.
Thank you so much, Doctor, for enlightening us on all these questions. I bet this has been so enriching for me. I hope for our viewers too. And to you, our viewers watching this video to this point, we want to say thank you for staying tuned. Please leave your thoughts in the comment section. Let us know what you think about all that has been said in this video. Remember to stay tuned to our channel. Thanks for watching this one. Doctor, thank you for being with us again.
Anytime.
Hope to see you when next we have a health talk or any worry that we'd like you to shed some light on. Okay, guys, I've been Reagan, your host. Behind the camera is Segun Aremu, saying thank you for watching and see you in our next video. Bye-bye. God bless you.